never know.
Okay, so very small school too. It's kind of weird.
Our next story looks like to get ahead in today's competitive job market, the 70-hour work week is becoming the new standard. Depressing. A recent study for the Center for Work-Life Policy finds that 1.7 million people consider their work hours to be extreme thanks to corporate expectations, Blackberries, and some of those type A personalities. The report says jobs with work weeks going way beyond 40 hours can be found throughout the economy, from retail to media to Wall Street. And we've talked about this before. But do you think that we're somewhat to blame in this? I understand that it's competitive. You don't stay for five extra hours at the end of the day. Somebody else will, and that person will be considered for the promotion. But do we have to buy into this, or is it being foisted upon
us? I have this conversation with my friends all the time, and I think this is a point. I don't know if you guys feel this way. I do. That you're working harder to stay in the same place.
Yeah. I know. I slave 3 hours a day here. It just kills me.
Absolutely kills me.
It used to be two.
Used to be two, now three.
I don't know what I'm going to do with myself.
Well, Mark and I were talking about this, not telling tales out of school. We have you know, 5,000 meetings here, and now we've got an extra meeting, and it's only 10 minutes long. It is killing us.
But it's important.
it's not killing us.
Rudy, I want to ask you, because the fact is you are your own boss, but do you find that you have to hustle even more?
Well, you know, being a musician, you're 24-7, so you really don't set a time, like, you know, so many hours.
You're on the clock.
Yeah, you're on the clock. And also from traveling around the world, a lot of countries, you know, 70 hours is a normal, you know, week.
But in a lot of countries, they take, when they vacation.
Especially in Europe.
Yes. They're very good about taking vacation.
Is the bass player who practices 20 hours a week better than the bass player who practices 5 hours a week?
Not necessarily. I practice less and less because what I try to do is I try to practice what I don't know. So instead of practicing, I try to learn, you know. But it all comes down to the musician that can get inside of the song and fit within the band the best.
All right, our next.
The problem with that theory, too, of the working hours thing is that there's some people who work becomes their life.
Mm-hmm.
And they're happy with that. And then other people who have families and that kind of stuff, they just can't keep up sometimes. Yeah, but true. Like you say,
every person's different. Yeah. And we all need to find balance in our own life. Our last story here, well, let's talk about body language. A new study says body language can help you or it can hurt you with job interviews. That's not really a big surprise, right? Mm-hmm. The way you sit, your eye contact, even if you speak with your hands, they all have an influence on the person interviewing you.
Yeah.
Experts say only a small percentage of communication actually involves words, only 7%. That's surprising. Only 7% of what you say is seen as important. 55% of communication is visual, body language, eye contact. 38% is the tone of your voice, how fast you talk, or how loud you speak. Interesting. I'm really surprised that only 7% of what you say. Do you believe this study?
Well, you know, have you ever, the other thing that's not included in this is if you go golf with somebody, it tells you an awful lot about the person.
Really?
Yeah. Whether they're straightforward, whether they cheat, whether they fudge, whether they are hard workers, whether they have any kind of an ethic, good sense of humor, whether they get along with people.
Right.
It's amazing what you find out.
I believe that
what just visually the body language and the intonations, I think, really says a lot about you.
I don't know if she would reveal all the secrets, but people who work in human resources now, when you fill out an application, they're looking beyond all the stuff that you write.
Right.
And I mean, I think there's a million sort of subliminal psychological tricks. I imagine in an interview circumstance, that's probably true too. Oh, he's crossing his legs.
Well, it's funny because when I'm listening, I do a lot of this. I cross my arms. It's just a comfortable way for me to stand. And I know that scene as being closed off and not open-minded. And I find myself catching myself thinking, am I being closed-minded right now? Or am I just standing, this is a comfortable way to stand?
I do it a lot and I am closed-minded. So, yeah.
How about you, Rudy?
I don't want to hear what you're saying at all.
Yeah, we too, as a matter of fact, on stage, well, we look at the facial expressions of our fans, and we know when to, you know, press the pedal or pull back a little bit.
Plus, and you have to rely on each other in terms of eye contact.
Are we rapping?
Are we going another round?
Plus, you have to project to the very, very back of the arena or you know, whatever venue you're playing.
It's a whole secret language, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Body language is important to a performer. It's everything, really.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. It tells a story.
The talent and, all that has to come out.
We got a lot to talk about with Rudy and his new book. And just a quick check of some entertainment items. Ray Liotta may be starring in that new big budget movie, Wild Hogs. John Travolta, William H. Macy, Martin Lawrence, Tim Allen. Today, though, dealing with bail and a court date scheduled right around the release of the movie in March. He was arrested for driving under the influence after crashing his car into two parked vehicles in Pacific Palisades. Leota is 52 years old. He was taken into custody Saturday evening around 8:30, booked on a misdemeanor DUI charge. And a couple to talk about, she's known for being extraordinarily litigious, so we want to tell you this was a report from the New York Post about some public displays of affection. The report says that Cameron Diaz spent some time canoodling and then sharing a car with Jaimin Hansu, who, of course, is the Oscar nominee for his fine work in Blood Diamond. All right, Rudy has a fine book here. Here's the thing that I'm thinking about. How many of your contemporaries, when you started with Quiet Riot or touring with Ozzy, are even around?
Oh, I think everybody's around. Yes, as far as I can look back, I mean, the people that, yeah, well, definitely. Definitely.
You see, I think a lot of people think, oh, because of, you know, substance abuse or whatever, people die off.
I you know what, if you look back, I think the 60s and the early 70s was the era where most of the musicians passed away from drug overdose. I think musicians today are way smarter than that. As a matter of fact, most of the musicians that I know are pretty sober right now.
Let me just show you the cover of the book. It is called Off the Rails, and of course you played with Quiet Riot, Dio, Ozzy.
White Snake.
What made you decide to write the book?
Well, from traveling for the last 25 years, we're traveling after Randy Rhoads passed away. The fans, I could always tell when a fan is going to come up to me and ask me, what was Randy Rhoads like? What was it, you know, like playing with Ozzy and Randy and all that? So basically, you know, every time I would sit down with somebody for, you know, for a few minutes, I was walked away feeling that it was not enough. I wanted them to really get the picture of what it was like, not only to play with Randy, but what it was like in 1981, 1982, whole different music industry. A whole different world than what it is today.
I loved reading the book, learning about your roots. You came from Cuba, your family
came from Cuba. Yeah,
and I want to talk to you about that, because coming to America and then not necessarily going towards the Cuban music scene, but stepping away from that into the American world of rock and roll. I'm sure you got some heat from your community.
It meant freedom. I mean, if you look at the history of any communist country, rock and roll, it's a taboo music, you know, because it's whether it's American music, you know, consider American music or whatever, but also it's considered rebellious. So as a matter of fact, now, and you know, in Dio, we've been touring former Soviet republics for the last 2 years. We were in Bulgaria, we were a whole month in Russia, and the fans are incredible because we're playing for them the type of music that they consider that got them through those dark years, you know.
Give us a quick glimpse, and we've only got a couple of seconds, but what was it like with Ozzy Osbourne during those years? Was it as we imagined, or worse?
It was magical. It really was. Going through the, it was my first exposure to playing in an arena band. You know, I went from sleeping on the floor to getting a phone call from Ozzy and Sharon to joining the band. So it was magic. It was like stepping through the Alice in Wonderland through that looking glass. It was just.
By the way, you look great in red leather. Yeah.
Do you still have that?
I don't want to go away from that. You just said you actually were sleeping on somebody's floor when you got the phone call to join Ozzy's band, and then you went to his mansion and you went, "Wow, what is this?"
Yeah,
it was. And then they offered you drugs.
Well, they were basically testing
you.
They were testing me because, you know, here I am, you know, we're about to start a tour within a couple of weeks. And who is this guy? You know, the reason why I got the opportunity was because Randy Rhoads, which is the reason why I wrote the book for him, he recommended me. I already played with him in Quiet Riot. You know, we were a local band, you know, and in Los Angeles. And he's the one who told Ozzy and Sharon, this is the guy, you know, you have to check this guy out. So I got the gig through him. And Randy was saying, okay, now, you know, watch out because they're going to be testing you because, you know, here they are about to embark on a major tour with a guy that
they don't even know.
They don't even.
But you did amazing, I mean, work. You not only performed tremendously, but you also said no and you kept yourself together because you realized the opportunity that was in
front
of you.
Well, by the time that I had the opportunity to play with Ozzy, I already, you know, gotten my religious beliefs together. You know, I knew where this gift was coming from, you know, just the opportunity to be doing what I always wanted to do in my life, you know.
Let me show you cover the book again. It's called Off the Rails, and Rudy tells some remarkable stories and a real great personal journey. Amazon.com is the place to pick it up. What a pleasure.
Thank you so much.
If you want to know more about Rudy, go to KTLA.com. We'll link to his website, because not only is he a great bass player, but he's a tremendous technical whiz kid, and he does all kinds of cool stuff. So, Rudy, great to see you here, buddy. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Nice to see you. Nice to meet you.
Coming up.